Okay. All right, we're going to call to order the meeting of the tri-board for the town of Hadley. And call the meeting to order at 6:04 p.m. So thank you, everybody, for attending. Tonight, we have members of the Finance Committee and a representative from the School Committee. And I believe tonight the primary focus is a continuation of our discussions last week about the five-year projection, the service delivery plan that David presented, and then we'd also like to have some conversation about the public forum that we're planning on holding September 14th. Okay. So with that in mind, I know one of the first questions that people asked last time, David, is as we head into the fall town meeting, free cash we're honing in on?
Right, so we're still working on that information. But based upon the preliminary budget summary for FY16, it looks like we're still in the neighborhood of $500,000 for certified free cash in the general fund. Mm-hmm. That number may go higher, but right now I think for comfort planning purposes, we talk about $500,000.
This is not likely to go lower.
I don't.
It's not like not likely.
Not likely to go lower. More likely than not to go higher.
Okay. And then today was the deadline for the special town meeting warrant. Is that
That's
correct?
That's right. So we have 26 articles that were submitted. We have a copy of the warrant. If it would be helpful, I can just go straight through the articles. The selectmen are scheduled to close the warrant later on today.
Right. I think it would be helpful for the tri-board to know what's on the.
Okay. So you should have two pieces of paper. The first one on my letterhead is a general letter explaining and providing additional background on the warrant articles. The second is the warrant itself, draft number 6. And it starts out with Article 1, which is the omnibus budget adjustment. We talked about coming back at the fall town meeting in order to make a number of changes to budgets that were passed at annual town meeting. Some of this would be in the form of providing non-union personnel a COLA, which was not provided for before. The other is to entertain expanded program proposals. One of the issues that came up was the cut to the school of $75,000. It wasn't really a cut. It was a funding at a level less than what was requested of $75,000. That information is contained here and as a restoration. We also have the OPEB funding at $251,000, which would keep us on track with our long-term goals for getting OPEB under control. There are other adjustments where we could take money away. So, for example, health insurance, I'm projecting that we can lower that by $25,000, maybe more, as we get into this. So that's Article 1.
David, just before you move on, can I ask a question?
Sure.
Just looking at the from and to columns, I'm recognizing everything from our budget discussions and annual town meeting. So the COLA, the police request, fire request, schools. But then when I get to, it says park commission expenses, $42,000. What was that request?
That was for rental, which we probably don't need at this point.
Okay, all right.
They were contemplating renting space, which we had found for them within existing town offices. So that can probably be adjusted downward.
Okay, all right, thank you.
So Article 1 is still something that's still very much in flux. And obviously will depend upon the availability of free cash. Article 2 was submitted by officers of the town, and they're looking for bonuses for officials holding certain certifications, and so that obviously has to be debated.
Mm-hmm.
Article 3 is a housekeeping measure in order to complete the changeover for Hadley Public Access TV. from a gift account which was funded by Charter Communication gifts from time to time to an enterprise fund which we set up at the annual town meeting. There's a surplus remaining in FY16 funds that would flow into the general fund unless we make this transfer. This amount is $90,970. That is not anything that impacts the tax rate. It's money that's already there, and we're simply changing the accounts. It includes the $67,000 gift from Charter Communications that came in on June 15, 2016.
Will that have to happen every year, or is this just a one-time thing?
This completes the process of complying with the new Department of Revenue requirements. So, housekeeping article, no impact upon taxes. Article 4 is something that we do at every town, our fall town meeting, which is we take an amount from free cash, which we hope is equivalent to the meals tax for the prior year, and place that into the capital stabilization account, which we then use as one of the funding sources for our capital. We received $315,000 in meals tax in FY16, and if we're so fortunate as to have free cash enough to support that figure, we would transfer that into the capital stabilization account. The next articles are a number of articles that relate to capital expenditures. First is the capital expenditures that are within the five-year capital plan, and it amounts to $2 million and change. There's a number of sources of funding that would support that appropriation. I guess the first thing to say before we dive into all these capital projects is that there's too much of them. We're going to have to make some changes here in order to keep this affordable. But there are some critical needs that are addressed in that first article. Article 6 is a request from the Municipal Building Committee to increase the building maintenance line item from, let's call it, $67,000 to $200,000, and the box there shows what they intend to spend money on. Just as in the narrative on the first piece of paper I've handed out, I do point out that there's $158,000 of money that's available for building maintenance that does not need a town meeting appropriation. That's already available. And so my recommendation, pending further information from the Municipal Building Committee, is that we allow them to spend down that already available money before we increase the budget from $67,000 to $200,000. Article 7 is first of the buildings. This is the fire substation, $3.6 million. This would have to be borrowed. Article 8, which was submitted by petition, is for the senior center. The language there is taken directly from the petition. We can't change or amend or edit the language. It's taken straight there. But we're in conversations with council and we're talking about $3.5 million with borrowing. The petition, all the petitions received or have been sent to the town clerk for certification for both the signatures and the form of the question. Article 9 is North Hadley Fire Station, again submitted by a petition, and this is to appropriate, take action to construct a North Hadley fire substation at North Hadley Hall ball field. Obviously, Article 7 and Article 9 are very closely linked, and so.
Do you need them both?
Well.
One's by petition.
One's by petition. You can't remove it unless there's a problem with the certification. But how we position this article, we can talk about it. Again, Article 10 is by petition. It calls for the demolition of North Hadley Village Hall in a two-year time period. Article 11 is submitted by the Municipal Building Committee, and it's for an unknown amount of money to undertake capital improvements on four public buildings. The amounts are to be determined, and I've asked for clarification on this. Article 12 is to borrow an unspecified amount of money to purchase property in North Hadley, again submitted by the Municipal Building Committee. this obviously needs to be debated because we haven't even received any bids for property up in the north end of town. Capital, with Article 13, again by Municipal Building Committee, is to provide additional money for a project consultant. In the narrative that I've provided for you, I do point out that there's something on the order of $46,000 remaining in the account that's for this purpose. That doesn't require a town meeting appropriation, so we should ask for further clarification from the Municipal Building Committee.
The Article number 12, where'd you get that from?
Article number 12?
Yeah.
That's from the Municipal Building Committee.
They submitted that to you?
That was the paperwork they gave me on the 17th.
I think there was only actually, okay, I'll clarify that. I believe that's not correct. There was only two articles in there that they were actually submitting.
Okay, all right.
I'll clarify that at the meeting next Tuesday.
I took what you gave me and I put it in there.
Okay.
David, is there a purpose listed for that Article 12, like what that purchase?
No, I think that's erroneous. I think that's last year's original one and was on the same piece of paper and is not intended for this year.
Okay.
Yeah, we would, in order to purchase property, we would have to specify a purpose. It'd be for general government or fire department or park and recreation or schools or highway purposes. There'd have to be some sort of further wordsmithing here. Article 14, and maybe this is one of those articles that shouldn't be here because of I was just taking the information that I received, and maybe that information contains too much, but they're looking to reallocate fund balances. This is something we should do anyways. It would be revenue neutral. So I can work with the accountant to come up with the appropriate numbers there. Article
wasn't 15, that done last year on the, in the spring of the town meeting floor?
It was, but it's something we should consider every year, or else have a bylaw.
Didn't we vote so it wouldn't be as confusing and we'd have the availability to move that should they deem it necessary?
Mm-hmm. Article 15 and 16 are the two library articles that we saw at the annual town meeting. Article 17A is to adjust the fees for the select board licenses, and I neglected to put in the administrative fee of $25 per application, so that's an amendment that will be coming. Right now we process these applications without any kind of administrative overhead charge. Other towns charge $25 or whatever is appropriate. And that's something that we should be presenting. But as part of our discussion about our revenue projections going to the future, we should be looking for opportunities to increase revenues. And one of the ways that we can do that is by adjusting fees.
That needs to be done on town meeting floor?
Right now it has to be done by town meeting floor, but we'll talk about that under Article 17B.
Can I ask about 17A real quick? There's
sure.
The second line item, all alcoholic on premise club, there's no change from and to.
Right.
Is that an intended?
That's intended.
Okay.
17B would allow us to adopt the Mass General Laws, Chapter 40, Section 22F, which means that the body that issues the permits or license can change their fees without a town meeting vote. Now, mind you, we tried this back in 2009. Town meeting voted it down. But I think that rather than having presenting these long, lengthy articles about fee adjustments, that that we ask one more time that the voters give us the authority to change without taking up time on town meeting floor to debate what a sealer in weights and measures should get for their measuring of a taxi meter.
Can we put that one first?
I see an or there. Is that 17A or 17B?
That's right. So I recommend that we put 17B.
B first.
B on and take 17A off. I think we would
vote. Yeah, if you vote B, then
yeah, you can pass over A.
No, I'd leave them both on. Because if B fails, then
just put it in the other order.
Are these, David, are these weights and measures all paying for our portion of the inspector? Is that why we're changing some of these? Or?
Yeah, we're changing them because we're not covering all of our costs with our sealer of weights and measures. We were able to cover those for FY16, but without the medical marijuana dispensary coming on board and the additional revenue from there, we're going to have a shortfall for the bill that we'll receive from the city of Northampton. So by making these adjustments, we should be able to cover our costs with the city of Northampton.
Clarification, when's the last time these were adjusted?
I have that information. I think it's 2014 for the alcohol licenses, and I think it was 2013 for the sealer of weights and measures. But I think other ones, I've asked the other departments to come up with a list of fees. So fire department was done in 2010. The building inspector fees weren't done until 2012. So it's been a number of years since we've adjusted some of these. Number 18, we have the Municipal Modernization Act, and most of these changes of the law happen automatically, and that we can go directly to the to that particular part of the act, and you know, make our operations better in terms of assessing, in terms of collections, in terms of permitting and procurement, and all these things that have been streamlined by the legislature and the governor. One of the things that we've always struggled with at licensing time is what to do with the license holders who owe us municipal charges or taxes. Under the current law, we can't take any action on withholding a permit or delaying a permit unless those municipal charges are more than 12 months old. The Modernization Act allows us to take action sooner than the 12 months, but only if we have a bylaw that says that all license holders should be in good standing. So here's a proposed bylaw in order to address that. And again, it helps us with our revenues. It also helps us with a perennial headache we have at licensing time in each December. Mm-hmm. That, you know, we know somebody owes us $25 on an inspection, but we can't do anything about it because we have to allow another 6 weeks to go by or something like that. Always happens, and this will help address that issue. Article 19 is a housekeeping issue. This has to do with the Chamorro Drive land transfer. There was an imperfection in the article, so in order to complete this project, we need to make one last change, and then we'll be done with that whole thing. I'm sorry that it's taken so long for it to happen.
This is drafted a little more one way than it's going to come out, right?
Yeah, so this is more conceptual and needs to be let run by legal.
Can I please call him and tell him it's coming on town meeting floor?
Yep.
Can we change it to Chamorro Road?
Yeah.
All right, Chamorro Drive.
You almost didn't know where that was, did you?
Right, I got lost.
You only lived there, right?
Gooseberry Lane is Mr. Iser came in today and said that Mr. Burkhume is ready for us to take that over. So this needs to be sent to DPW, the planning board. It would be part of our strategy that we talked about of taking these private roads and turning them into public roads.
But we need the planning board's sign off that was the spec, right?
Absolutely, as well as Mr. Warner.
Okay.
And then we have to do the walking of the road.
We have to do the walking, we have to do the taking. Two articles for CPA. The first one is a housekeeping article. The Kestrel Trust is not ready to move forward on their dam restoration, and there's a sunset provision in their funding of $100,000 for this project, simply moving the sunset provision from the end of the year 2016 to the end of the year 2017.
That's the third time that's been moved?
Mm-hmm. At least twice. This would be the second time. They did go out to bid. The bids did come in way more than their available budget. So
there's a reason. Yeah.
Article 22, this is Hopkins Academy, playing fields for additional design, and if you have any comments on that, but this was approved on Monday.
They also put a time boundary around it for funds to be used by a year from the town meeting.
Okay.
So they'll put that in there.
All right. That, in fact, will not be legal. I mean, we can have it in there, but the funds will not automatically sunset without some sort of additional town meeting vote afterwards.
So to change it back, it would have to be town meeting vote to the opposite effect.
So.
So it will be in effect until it's voted not in effect.
Okay.
Do we need to let Edwin know that, though?
Yeah, I think that's their understanding.
I definitely will. So just to let him know that.
In fact, they subject to the Lake Warner.
One town, the principle here is that one town meeting cannot compel a future town meeting what to do. And that's the effect of putting sunset provisions in this, that you may not use the money after that, but it doesn't revert back to CPA until there's some sort of automatic transfer, some sort of active transfer of that money.
I see Article 21 now as being out of order, if that's indeed true. Because Article 21 is reestablishing the money that's already been appropriated.
Right, right.
So we need to tell Edwin one way or t'other, but.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can take.
Or the CPA committee.
Take the pig and grind it into sausage. You can't take the sausage and grind it.
If he doesn't need it, he should know.
Right. Article 23, 24, 25, and 26 are the planning board. The first two are the zoning articles that were initially presented on the town meeting for annual town meeting. There are apparently a number of changes in that planning board skipped them over. I have sent these versions to the planning board for their comments to make sure that we have everything in the format that they prefer. And then I'm advised by the planning board that they may have as many as three additional articles. So there we are.
Back to Article 2. Can you explain that again, please?
As much as I know, there was a request from people in town hall that if they hold a certain certification, that they get some sort of bonus for that.
Where'd that come from?
It came from downstairs. And again, I think we need to debate this one.
Is.
Downstairs meaning the collector, the treasurer, oh, no, treasurer's upstairs.
Yeah, yeah.
The assessor, clerk.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, all right. Question on the placement of articles?
Yeah.
Just because the point was pondered to me. When they're petitioned articles, is it at the purview of the select board where they fall, or?
Yes, so the warrant at this point, which I recommend that you take it under advisement once you close it, the warrant at this point is your warrant. You sign it. And so I always reckon that you have complete say over what's on it, how it's presented, and what sequence of articles what sequence are the articles presented to the voters. Some towns choose to position things strategically. Other towns take their lottery system and present their articles as generated by random numbers. I don't recommend that, but sometimes do it that way in order to present a warrant that is perceived as fair as it possibly can be. I always think that there's a logical sequence for our warrants, and so this is the way I presented initially, but you're free to change the order.
In my past life as a town moderator, there is first six articles, the rest of them come out of a hat.
No discussion point?
Are there any of these articles that can be put into, what did we do last time? There was a set of articles that consent?
Consent.
Yes.
Oh, yes. That's up to, it's up to the moderator. We typically do consent articles at the beginning, at the annual town meeting, not at the fall town meeting, but there's no reason why we couldn't put certain ones in consent.
It's typically the housekeeping, right?
Yeah, I think the housekeeping ones, the ones that don't require debate.
Mm-hmm.
I think there are two or three slam dunks that we want to do.
And then, so it's safe to say, if for the sake of argument, we have, we believe we may have 500,000 of free cash, we have an article for 315 to go to the capital stabilization.
Mm-hmm.
We have OPEB of 251 or whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
And then clearly some, so, I mean, everybody should know that at this point, we should reasonably expect that there are articles that are going to add up to a sum that's greater than what our free cash will allow.
Right.
Just to be clear about that.
Right. So we have to look at other sorts of funding. I've tried to parse out as best I possibly can where other sources of funding may come from that wouldn't affect the tax rate. There's certainly going to be some of these that we'll have to borrow for, and we present you with information about what that borrowing looks like and its impact upon the general fund and the two enterprise funds.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, so we'll be taking the warrant up on our regular agenda later in terms of closing it. So, Mark and Linda, since the last meeting, are there any updates that either of you wanted to provide to the group? Anything new?
We haven't met, so we haven't given any significant updates. As you know, we're still looking for another volunteer who's been joining our committee.
Right.
Fill it out. And I just one question on Article 2 regarding bonuses. If the position requires to have that certification, why would you give them a bonus?
We don't have any information on it.
This has been discussed for quite a few years with all the professional licensees that carry the licenses from the state for their jobs.
I don't get a bonus to having my license.
But we'll be debating that at a future point in time. I'm sure you'll be welcome to the conversation. Linda, do you have, or Heather, she's right in front of me.
I apologize that both Heather and I missed the last meeting. And I think two things came up about the schools. One was charter and choice reimbursement. So we have a few numbers if you want us to go through that tonight.
Sure, if you want to, yeah.
And I think what also came up was that you mentioned a ranking that you saw about schools. So I have more information about that if we want to talk about that. And you and I have talked separately about whether we as a town want to take a stand on the ballot question about charter schools.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm ready to talk about all three, but I don't know what the agenda is.
We have a half an hour to kill. So
I'd like to hear all three of those articles.
Yeah.
In your priority.
All right, so Molly presented some numbers about the difference between choice and charter last time, and the bottom line was that we are sending out more, $300,000 more, in combined choice and charter. So that is true, but you didn't have 17 numbers in your presentation.
Yeah.
The difference between 16 and 17 is very good for the town and the schools. There's a $100,000 difference to the good, meaning that less Hadley kids are leaving the schools and more non-Hadley kids are coming into the schools for choice. So that's our good news. It's $100,000 to the good. Comparing choice and charter, and this can get us into the discussion about the ballot question, it's really an unfair comparison in many ways because what the choice reimbursement is $5,000 per child because the philosophy of choice is that you are filling an existing seat, a seat that is already in the classroom unfilled. And that $5,000 reimbursement number hasn't been changed since
we started
years.
Since
decades.
1993,
decades.
I believe, when Chapter 70 was put into place.
No.
Charter reimbursement, what we have to pay out to have a kid go to charter school, assumes that school is creating a seat. So the seat doesn't exist. We need to create the classroom. So we put out for every kid that goes to a charter school $16,000. So the fact that we are bringing in that we are $100,000 to the good with choice is really good. The problem that I believe we have is that it is an unfair reimbursement, that the assumption we are filling a seat with choice but creating a seat with charter. So Annie and I did a pretend look at that.
Mm-hmm.
And if we assumed that we got $16,000 for choice kids, we would be bringing in $849,000. and we would be to the good $253,000. If we assumed that the charter reimbursement change from $16,000 to the $5,000, we would be good $60,000 instead of bad $300,000. So I think the schools are doing really a very good job. We are competing against two niche schools, one, the Pioneer Valley Chinese Immersion School, and two, Pioneer Valley Performing Arts, that are offering things that we as a typical K through 12 can't offer. I will say that right now the Chinese Immersion School has an application in to double their size again. If that happens, we should expect, unless we can change the legislation about the reimbursement to charter schools, our situation will get worse because it's a doubling of their size. Unfortunately, at the top of the pack, which I told Molly, the top of this application is a letter from the Hadley Select Board written in 2013 at endorsing the expansion of the school. And I assume the board did that without thinking through the financial implications. So getting us to question two lifts the cap on charter schools. School committee met last night. We did not take a stand on that. My hope, speaking only for myself, is that the school committee and the select board will take a stance to oppose the expansion of charter schools, at least until we can deal with that reimbursement amount. That if it was a more level playing field between K through 12 typical public schools and charter, then I think that lifting the charter cap would be okay. But it's hard for me to support
that. Not a 2-to-1, yeah.
It's got to have equality. If there's equality there, mm-hmm. then this goes away virtually for a problem. How about let's talk about Smith for a minute and that cost for sending kids to Smithville going to, what, $22,000 a student now when we have no voice at the table as to what controlling expenses over there?
Yep. I've talked to our legislators about that. It's a hard one to fix. We can continue to advocate for that. And again, I think it's a place where the school committee and the select board can advocate together. Smith is the only school like it. Mm-hmm. Every other tech school has
one voice.
Has a voice. Yeah. We would have a voice. You know, we do have the possibility of saying, unless our kids want to go into the ag program, we want to send them to a different tech school. I don't know if the town would support that, because we have a tradition of sending our kids to Smith Folk, and we've talked about this before. There is a shortage of middle skills and folk students. There are jobs there. It's a financial problem when we have no voice at Smith Folk.
Is there a comparison as to what it would cost to go to Franklin Tech or the Pathfinder?
I don't know. But at least we'd have a vote.
Didn't East Hampton choose to do that, I believe?
Yeah.
Yes, they send their kids to Lower Pioneer Valley.
Right.
So the reason, part of the reason that Linda and I were talking about this is, again, the schools have their own budget, so the Smith Folk tuition's rolling through your budget, through your operating budget. But we all know that the school choice coming in stays with the schools, but everything else is then flowing through the cherry sheet that's coming back onto the state aid line item for the town. And it seems like this might be a good opportunity for us to join forces, because I firmly believe that when you're dealing with the legislature, speaking with you on a united front carries far more weight than either one of us doing it on our own. And if, in fact, it's the will of the board to support the recommendation from the school committee, I'm hoping that we would at least give that hearing and consider putting our putting our name on that as well. So it's nothing we have to decide tonight, but, I think it would be a good thing.
I agree with what you're saying, Molly, and I'd also like to rewrite that letter, or at least have a discussion regarding the rewrite on that letter and the implication to the community by having us, having the school, enlarge itself too. So
was that something that
we did it back then in 2013 when they were putting the addition on at that time. We did not endorse enlarging it any further than what it is.
So that was making it K through 12, right? Wasn't that the point of the addition?
I think so.
No, it was K through 8.
You might be right.
Oh, okay, and then the...
And they wanted to go to K through 12. We only did the K through 8.
What is it now?
They're looking for K through 12.
They're at K through 8 now?
Yeah, but they don't have the facility for it right now.
They were turned down once, but that doesn't mean that...
Well, they use the whole parking lot in front of Michael's to park for their kids over there. I mean, when you go over to that parking lot, you can't get in there. And in the afternoon, there's heavy traffic of getting in and out of there from the school, even in the parking lot. I voted many years of the 15 years I was on school committee. I voted no for charter school. For us, Stephen belonged to school of choice because I didn't feel it was the proper thing to do in pitting school systems against one another. And I'm still a firm believer in that. But you had to buckle under because you were losing money, you were losing students, and you had to go with it. I mean, it was the last year I was on school committee that I finally said yes. Mm-hmm. And that was the only reason why. And I think it's awful that you have to do that between school systems. No. Everybody should get a fair amount and a fair shake and be able to offer the kids whatever is offered anywhere else.
Our student population from Hadley's going down, though, huh?
Slowly.
Mm-hmm. Slowly?
It's projected to go down.
Mm-hmm. Same as Hampshire County.
Yeah, almost. All of Hampshire County.
Yeah.
Because we've become a bedroom community. We have people from surrounding towns that are moving here because they're in the retirement age. They want to come here for the taxes mm-hmm. that we have, mm-hmm. and it's a lot less than what's in our surrounding towns. Yeah.
And Linda, you also wanted to address the rankings, and then there was one other thing. We also started a conversation about shared services, which came up at our tri-board last time, so I was hoping to bring that up too.
So I assume the ranking you were talking about came from greatschools.org?
I picked up online at Zillow and realtor.com.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, just the point is that other people who are looking at our community are going to look at those types of numbers and compare it to other towns. And if you want tax revenue to go up, you know, the high tide floats all boats. So if property values went up because of the quality of education sought here, then you all benefit.
Yeah, so we looked at the greatschools.org data, and unfortunately it's old and wrong, and the comments are from 2009 and 2011. And so that is unfortunate, but you know they have ranked us lower. They've used MCAT. They've used incorrect MCAT scores, so that's a bit of a drag for us.
Is there a correction mechanism?
I don't know. That's what we need to look into, whether we can, you know, take the comments off from 2009, because that was a long time ago. Many things have changed since 2009.
Administrations ago. Yeah.
Yeah. But you know, I guess the counter to that is that I went on to realtor.com to look for it, and also read an article about how much do school districts affect real estate. And really, and also on realtor.com is a document that says good schools provide stability for a community, and that's good for property values of everyone who lives nearby. And it's an entire article about the way you have high real estate values if you have strong, good schools. So realtor.com is doing, could help the schools, and by using this bad website, it's a problem that we need to try to fix.
Right. Yeah. We're just trying to figure out what we need to do to get those numbers up.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like the first order of business is get them the right information. Well, and see
and
what
the,
they are.
And the numbers are up. The numbers they're using are from 13 and 14, and all of our numbers are up since then. And they also reported the numbers lower than they were, even in 13, 14.
Mm-hmm. At least 13 and 14 is, you know, within the last 10 years, or not 9. Right. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thanks.
And shared services.
Yeah, so the other thing that Linda and I just had a brief conversation about, and we wanted to bring back to the tri-board was, you know, whether or not, you know, we were talking about the challenges that we're facing and how best to provide not only how best to continue to deliver through the service delivery plan that that David had prepared, you know, make sure that those deliveries of services maintain the highest level of quality, but we were also pondering the challenge of the fact that there are probably some much-needed services that are not being provided right now. And in our conversation at the last meeting, we specifically were talking about human resources, we were talking about information technology, leadership, and management, and we talked about, you know, some form of centralized purchasing. I mean, these are things that other municipal governments have in place in some shape, manner, or form, and there are a variety of ways to skin the cat. I mean, you can have a dedicated position, which is certainly going to cost money. You know, you're talking about a full-time benefited position for most of these things. You can outsource. Our information technology consultant said that some municipalities just outsource that function completely to a third party. Or you also can find a way to regionalize it in some way. And the closest regionalization I could think of was across the street, which is the school department. And we've talked about that in the past, about whether or not it might make sense for us to look at working together with the schools. So if they have a similar need to the town side, for lack of a better way to put it, is there any opportunity for us to explore sharing a position like that? Could we have one IT person that covered the whole town to make it more cost effective? Could we have one human resource department? Or maybe the schools don't need human resources the way that the town side does because of unions. I mean,
We still use one person for human resource for even the school department. I mean, it's Joni. I mean, she does all of the human resource things anyway, so I mean, we are using just one person.
Right.
So
it's too bad we didn't have an expert in the room that could tell us how the COG in Franklin County works, because I've heard that's been expertly utilized up there in some of the sharing of services.
Oh, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it, but I do know we have one person that does try to take care of the whole town, and that's sometimes a little bit too much for one person to do.
Right, but I think what we're talking about is different from what Joni's employee benefits, and she does a great job with the payroll processing and the employee benefit side of it. When we're talking about human resources, we're talking about job descriptions, performance review process, we're talking about grievances, I mean, all of those things that, I mean, Joni, I hope I'm not speaking out of school, doesn't have time to even contemplate handling that, nor is she trained as an HR professional.
It's a growing area. We have, even in the year and a half that I've been here, I'm seeing it taken more of her time, of my time, and of David's time. We've got a number of issues we're dealing with right now.
Yeah.
It would be good to have someone who has a better background. Yeah.
Right. And another thing that came up, David and I were in a meeting with the superintendent on Monday and the accountant, and we were talking about the VADAR system and how we're currently utilizing that. And one of the things that came up is the version that the school department is using right now is an older version of the software than what the town is utilizing. So there was very cooperative conversation about how can we bring those versions up to be compatible. And in the process of that conversation, posed the question about a purchase order system, which we're not utilizing right now. And again, that's something that's down the road, but ultimately could potentially save us an awful lot in terms of workflow, approval, better control over expenditures, and that type of system really kind of begs one individual overseeing all of it, so that if we need toilet paper and the schools need toilet paper, we do one toilet paper order, all of that kind of stuff. I don't know why I thought of that, I just didn't.
I didn't know.
I could add a comment to that. I'm not going to.
But the other thing Molly and I talked about, to your point, Jerry, is that one of the things we're doing at our COG is looking at shared human resource functions, and are just about to go have a contract with the UMass Collins Center to look at shared human resources between several towns. And so maybe you and Bob Dean could talk to see if Hadley could just come on in to that project, since we're doing it anyway. I think we have 5 or 6 towns that are interested in doing it.
Yeah, and this is a conversation that we've had off and on with the COG for a while, so
you know,
I'll follow up on that with Bob tomorrow.
About sharing building and grounds maintenance?
Yeah, and that was another one too, thank you. Forgot that one. So again, it seems like, I think, to your point, the school department right now is extremely happy with the services that they're getting internally, but then we've also talked about, you know, and those two schools probably beg the full-time maintenance, but we've also talked about the, you know, mowing and
Sharing equipment,
yeah, things like that, and whether or not it would make sense to have that centralized in one area. So the answer, do you need to go back to the school committee and
talk? About sharing services?
Right.
Yeah. Well, I think we should have further discussion, maybe offline, maybe mm-hmm. you and I or you and Annie can have a conversation about what makes the most sense
mm-hmm.
and come up with kind of a prioritized list of what we think would be most practical, most cost efficient, and what could be implemented most quickly, and then maybe you and Annie come back here.
Yep.
I think that's how I would do it, rather than use Cam's tone.
Right. Is everybody comfortable with that?
Yeah, let's prioritize things. We won't be able to do everything, but if we can come up with a priority list and what's the most feasible and what's most cost effective to jointly share, I think that's, let's walk and then run.
Okay, that's good. All right, good. So I think the other thing that we really wanted to talk about was getting ready for, we have a public forum scheduled for the 14th. We're still looking for a venue, which would be important.
We can tell you where it's not going to be. Okay.
Here.
Not going to be here. It's not going to be at the senior center, elementary school. So we're asking for space at the Frontier.
Frontier.
I'm just gonna repeat that I'm still jet laggy from the West Coast. Give me
he
a moment.
He was out in the Frontier.
Yeah. I've got an air bubble.
Yeah. How about Hopkins Academy?
That's better.
How about the famous Hopkins Academy?
Mm-hmm. So conceptually, the thought behind the forum again, I know we keep repeating, bears repeating.
Well, do you want to have him see if it's available?
Yeah, we're working on that right now.
Right, but I mean, it's only assuming that we get the room. We need to
have
be standing up there
say.
And have a forum and tell people something. So I think what we talked about was, you know, again, making clear the point of the forum is to provide people with an overview. The intent isn't to come in there and say, you know, okay, we're all done. We've got a five-year plan put together. Here you go. That the forum is actually an integral part of developing that plan. But we want to inform people where we are as a town. Focus on the challenges for sure, but also make sure people are aware of some of the good things, the accomplishments that we've made. But talk about things like on the revenue side, you know, where are we at with the gas moratorium? You know, what does that look like? How is that impacting revenue?
Not good, according to the paper this morning.
Yeah, I'll tell you later. I went to the yeah. hearing last night. Our legislators are doing a fantastic job, but yeah, it's a challenge.
Mm-hmm.
So the gas moratorium, how that's impacting revenues. You know, again, the constraints on the state aid, when you look at it, I mean, everything's kind of leading back to the property taxes, so.
So this is a state of the union of the town is where it sits now.
Mm-hmm.
It's
right.
not going to be a precursor to town meeting.
Correct. Precursor to town meeting is really just going over the warrant articles on the 20th, you know.
Okay.
But talk about where we're at with all of the buildings, the challenges. So again, you know, what are the challenges we're facing? And I think the select board's already gone on record saying that our, you know, at least one of our priorities is public safety, that we're focusing there, that everything's not going to happen overnight. But here are the issues in the DPW, here are the challenges in the school department that, you know, you'd be speaking to that.
You'd be asking the municipal building committee to speak to any of these issues?
What I was hoping, I talked to David a little bit today about it, that, first of all, it would be great if all of the department heads could be there, or at least have some representation, because I'm sure that people will have questions, and you want the people who are on the front line answering them. So yeah, I mean, I think the Municipal Building Committee certainly would want to have representation there so that they can, but the intent isn't that each person get up and make a presentation. I think the idea would be that we're providing an overview.
Because you're only having this as a 2-hour window, too.
Exactly, otherwise people would point out.
It's not going to be there until midnight that night, you know.
But they'd be there on the 20th and not the 14th.
14th, yeah.
I just looked at the school calendar, and September 14th is Hawkins Open House, so.
That would be a problem, then.
Yeah.
What's wrong with the grammar school?
We had to leave by 8 o'clock.
8 o'clock, is that correct? So we don't want to feel like that we're rushing through this.
And I don't, I would prefer we not do it on the night of Hawkins Open House.
That's early, isn't it normally the 20-something?
The following is the elementary school open house on the 22nd.
It varies.
Okay.
Mirror year.
On the 22nd?
The 22nd is elementary school open house.
So you want to try for the 21st?
The 20th and the 21st?
I'm not here.
You're not here.
The senior center is available every day except the 14th. You could move it to the senior center on the 13th or the 15th. On either side of that Wednesday, if you wanted to go on a Tuesday or Thursday.
Let's go Tuesday.
Yeah.
It's okay with me.
The North Hadley Hall is vacant.
The who?
And available.
The what?
The North Hadley Hall, Village Hall is vacant and available.
Oh, great.
13th.
Festival.
I think not.
Is it handicap accessible?
13th looks good to me.
At Sway, council either. Or now we, I bet we could go, we could try Hawkins or senior center.
13th's okay with me, I don't know.
The senior center said they were happy to host. I had spoken to Suzanne about their availability.
Oh, okay, so they're available that night?
They are available that night.
Okay.
I'd rather be at Hawkins.
You'd rather be at Hawkins?
Yeah, I think it's more convenient.
Okay.
Well, parking certainly.
Right, exactly.
Parking.
Sorry, so.
I have to check their calendar.
Yeah, we'll have to check with Hawkins.
13th.
Okay.
We doing October, September, where are we?
September.
September 13th, Hawkins.
There's nothing posted on the school calendar that day, but that, you know, I don't know.
All right, so we could check into it. It could be Hawkins or the senior center.
It felt like the first day of school is not the right time to call, so.
Right.
Thank you.
So we're going to want to get word out, though, that we've changed the date on that, so we just.
Okay.
Okay. All right, well, that was important to know. See, it's good to have everybody at Tri-Board.
So are you thinking a PowerPoint? Are you thinking different places people can wander? Are you thinking?
No, I'm thinking one, yeah, one, everybody listening to the same thing at the same time. Possibly a PowerPoint, but less paper. I mean, I think if we do a PowerPoint, we'd want it condensed to some short bullets and just a few graphs. You know, the trend types of things that we've done. Justin's done some nice things with the budget to show like a pie chart and how it's split apart and everything. Linda's done a lot of work on the debt schedule. It's probably important information for people to have, so we separate kind of fact from fiction, right? So, but, you know, again, not much more than that. And I think you guys already have the PowerPoint you did for the budget process, right?
We have that, and we have the 5-year projection. So we could do a combination of the two. So I assume we will assume it's a PowerPoint, and we will create a presentation that is a combination of our, explains our budget and our 5-year projection. Annie will be in touch with David on that, okay?
And from.
30 minutes, no.
But soon, this is only 2 weeks away.
Exactly.
15 or 10 or 15 minutes apiece per.
Yeah, I mean, I'm thinking.
Somewhere in that area, so that you're, you know.
Presentation.
Condenses it a little bit.
Yeah, no more than 45 minutes of talking.
Total.
Total, right.
Talking, and then.
Yeah, open.
Open for discussion and.
Do you want it televised?
I would hope, yeah, that we would be able to work that out.
It'd be helpful, absolutely be helpful.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll work that out with HPAC.
We can have some resource documents already posted online, so we can refer to them. If you want to see the audit, here it is. If you want to see the service delivery plan, here it is. Everybody's got a device these days.
Sure. Okay, does that sound Sound good? So I'm sure we'll be spending more time talking about it at our next meeting too. Should we all want to look over the content?
What time is it gonna be?
Probably 7.
Are we gonna try to meet again to review it as a group or wing it on the 13th? Never my favorite thing.
Yeah, so this next select board meeting is on the 7th, and we also have a department head that morning as well, so.
Oh, good. So maybe that, I'll tell Annie the deadline is, our deadline is the 6th?
Right.
Okay.
Okay.
Joyce was just mentioning, she's wondering if, and this is an issue, and I know, John, you've brought this up before too, for seniors who don't care to drive in the evening. I mean, having it televised will be very helpful.
Yeah.
But should we consider starting it at 6:30 instead of 7, just to even pick up another, make it a little bit earlier?
Does that sound good? At 6:30?
Maybe council on aging, if there are van available, anybody can arrive to, maybe we can get hold of them.
Yeah.
The council on aging has the van available for picking up seniors who do not drive and want to get to either polling places or open forums.
Yeah, I'm sure we can get all of Suzanne or your board and see if we can get somebody to drive in.
Okay, all right, so let's change the plan then to 6:30.
13th at 6:30.
Tuesday the 13th, perfect, the 13th.
Pending approval from the school.
Okay. Yeah, right.
And do we want to try to have another tri-board meeting on the 7th to review everything and make sure we're all on the same page on it?
I think coordination is only going to help, so
I don't think we need to call it a tri-board. We could call it a pre-meeting,
oh,
so everybody's invited.
Yeah,
good
idea. It's
just right.
Organization.
Next week.
So would we start?
Yeah.
Would we start that at 6 o'clock?
That's next week, and Labor Day's Monday.
That's right.
So it's not very much time to prepare.
So we have to post on Friday.
Is that not? Is that ridiculous? Or
it is. It's really tight.
We could do it.
We
could try meeting.
I mean, on our side, we have a lot of this information ready to go. So. I think we present what we have.
Okay, I mean, I'm looking at you, realizing
yeah.
that,
it's work.
Again,
yeah.
it's there's
yeah.
work to be done.
Right.
I think that's a lot to ask.
What are you going to do, Joyce? You got another one the week after.
That's,
yeah.
So, I mean,
I
agree.
Well, let's post for the 7th, and if we aren't done,
we have another
let's
the week
think
after.
About the
20th. The 20th, we have the one about the town meeting.
Yeah.
Right.
So, maybe only, do we need, how about if we do 6:30 for that? Do we need the full hour, do you think, or?
We're gonna have other people involved with it that may wanna, you know, talk a little bit about their stuff too and the coordination and the timing, so.
Okay, so 6 o'clock?
Yeah.
6 o'clock?
6 o'clock tri-board.
No.
Planning.
Forum planning.
Yeah, right. Planning meeting.
I'm out of town.
You're out of town on the
7th? Yeah.
Okay.
Your material will be mostly put together though, right, I mean.
So what are you meeting at, what time?
6 o'clock.
Anniversary.
Okay.
And you're saying we have
higher calling, that's called.
Yeah. We have a meeting on the 20th, you're saying? On that Tuesday?
No. No, so the forum is the 13th, so on the 7th we're going to meet with anybody interested in going through the presentation material.
Okay. But
at
then,
6.
Then we don't have another meeting till the 21st of September?
Right. We wouldn't be meeting on the 14th.
Okay.
Then I have assumed for the 21st.
Okay.
Right? Yeah.
Didn't you just tell me that the meeting on, there was going to be a meeting on the 20th as a precursor to town meeting?
No.
That's October.
October 20th.
October 20th for town meeting. Sorry. Okay. Anything else for tri-board?
Chapter 7.
Thank you.
Well,
yeah.
Good job.
Beautiful timing.
I am right on time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Linda and Mark, we're going to try to set up a capital planning committee for the 12th of September. Does that work for you all?
Yes, like Monday?
The 12th Monday.
6?
5:30?
Sure.
The
12th? I'm not here.
12th, you're not here. Okay. At least the first meeting, Jerry, you're the chair, so you call the shot, but I think the first meeting is just to review what's in, what's out, and then we set up meetings with the departments.
You can feel comfortable. There'll be no decisions made. We'll talk about what the projects are that are on the table. Keep you abreast of it all.
All right.
Okay, and we'll talk to Paul and to...
So it's on 12th?
On the 12th.
Okay.
5:30.
All right, see you then.
All right, thanks.
All right, thank you. All right, then we'll move into the...
And sorry, Linda, does that work for you as well?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Jet lag, jet lag, jet lag.
That's good.
Geez, we kind of had a quorum here, didn't we?
Yeah.
Were we posted?
Okay, so we're going to move into our regularly scheduled select board meeting for tonight. And first order of business is the consent agenda. So what we have for the consent agenda...
I'm going to ask that you remove the August 17th minutes, or postpone them.
Okay. But we do have the July 20th?
Yes.
Yeah, so, yes, so we have the July 20th meeting minutes here for approval. We also have warrants, 1708S and 1709. We have an APR agreement. That's correct. And then three appointments to the Cultural Council. Maureen Shea, Catalina Arubla, and Katie Richardson.
Make a motion to accept the consent agenda. Consent agenda.
Second motion.
Any discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, so we will allow for public comment this evening. Is there anyone here for the public comment period? No? Okay. The town administrator's report is a standing item. David was on vacation last week, and even though I do believe David probably would have a full week's worth of work-related update based on his activities that week, you get a pass.
I recommend we find out his vacation things on separately.
Great.
Had a fine time, thank you.
We know, we got to talk to you, right?
That's, yeah, I was just saying, we know. Okay.
I believe the chief is. Yeah, in the hallway.
I was just going to say, so we do have an appointment with the police for police appointments. I didn't notice a specific time for this, so Chief Mason, are you ready for the appointments?
I am.
You are, okay. All right, then.
Sorry, we had a little situation going on with...
Little situation?
Yeah, there was going to be some officers here to kind of support him, but they're all busy doing something.
Okay, I like that commercial on TV.
I got a situation.
Yes, you have a situation here.
Hi, how are you? Good, have a seat.
Seat.
Hot seat.
So, seated before you is Officer Christopher Roder. I am going to be recommending him tonight for a replacement full-time position. We had one of our full-timers resign. We have a position open. We'd like to get a new officer in as soon as possible so we can, you know, stop filling that spot with overtime and part-time help and stuff. Chris has been with us since 2013. He's a veteran of the United States Army, where he served as a combat medic for operations in Iraq and Afghanistan. He currently serves as an active member of the U.S. Army Reserve and holds the rank of Sergeant First Class. He started with us as a special police officer, was hired by Chief Huckowitz, and was promoted to part-time officer in 2014. Chris has made our department a priority when it comes to working shifts and is always readily available when we need him. He showed his eagerness to be a full-time officer by self-sponsoring through the full-time academy and paying his own way for that certification. Chris navigated our new hiring process that we just went through for full-time, and he was selected by the committee as the unanimous number one choice for the open full-time position. I brought Chris here tonight to recommend him to you folks for selection for our newest full-time police officer.
Great. I make a motion to accept Chris as a full-time police officer.
Thank you.
Do I have a second?
I would second that motion.
Okay. Any discussion?
Have anything for us?
No, I just want to thank you all for the opportunity. I'm excited.
Wait, first of all.
So we haven't voted yet.
It'll be 1 second.
Nice and neat.
So hold that thought. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Chris, would you like to say anything?
I'm excited. It's been something I've been working hard for quite a while, so it's a great feeling to have it come full circle. And I'm looking forward to continuing to serve the town of Hadley.
Excellent. Well, thank you.
Glad to have you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chief.
Thanks.
I'll be out in the morning.
You didn't just lose a road crew guy, did you? He's been on the road for the last three months.
He'll still have days off. He can work those. Did you want to deal with did you have any questions for me about the conjoined issue with this, or?
Do you want to go ahead and speak to it?
I presented some paperwork to the board over the past week. It's just trying to keep it short. Just a one-page just request for some guidance on where we're headed. Several months back, we presented a PowerPoint as it relates to hiring more officers. We presented our budget request to the Finance Committee. We presented it also to you folks, and we have come to several finance or tri-board meetings to answer any questions that we may have. I know that both the Finance Committee and the board were in support of the budget, but obviously the completion of that budget request doesn't come until going before a fall town meeting. But there was a question on our part as to whether or not, because we had talked about phasing this project in, whether or not that was still an option. We didn't know if we were going to be able to hire any extra people. My understanding of it was that we were going to phase in from spring to fall. And if in fall our expanded budget or expanded budget request was voted down, we would have to deal with that and figure out how to move forward. But as of right now, we've kind of been in a holding pattern and don't really know where we're going, what the phases actually are. We have done our hiring process. We have at least three candidates, possibly four, that we have identified as potential full-time officers for these new positions. So we are ready whenever you folks are. And I don't want to sound like, I don't want to beat a dead horse here. I know you've heard me talk about this a lot. So I guess the reason for my letter was simply to look, ask for some more guidance as to where we're headed. And if that means that we wait until fall town meeting and that's the recommendation, then that's fine. But we have a group of officers who, this has been a many-step process, and there's been a lot of balls in the air trying to make this happen. One of those processes was to tailor the police contract in a way that if we hired new officers, we weren't going to put ourselves in a worse position with the overtime. And Joyce, as being on the negotiation team, they've done that. So, like I said, I'm just looking for a little bit of guidance on which direction we're headed. Are we waiting longer, or are we ready to move? And I don't bring this up that it needs to be answered today. Mm-hmm. I gave you folks that documentation so you could kind of read it and get your thoughts in order and tell me if there's a place I need to be in the future to discuss it or not.
Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering, it would be helpful to have, from a financial standpoint, the end of this fiscal year, your department turned back a fair amount of money.
Yeah.
Right. So
that's correct.
Thank you for your contribution for his free cash. Right.
Right.
Right. And then right now on the fall warrant, we have 48,000 and
something
change.
Like that. We can revisit. Those numbers were good as of the annual town meeting.
Right.
Things probably have changed, so we'll be tightening those figures up. But
Right.
We need to know what that financial gap is.
I completely understand that.
Is there a timeframe that we could offer, that we could try to get back to chief?
Where are you at with the specials and the part-times right now? How many do you have?
We just hired, what, four more?
Mm-hmm.
Our last select board meeting.
I'm just thinking it'd be helpful to have revised information in front of us. And I mean, I'd be happy to recommend we do it at the next meeting if.
Week from tonight?
Like I said.
Could we talk about it a week from tonight, but could you work with David on revising, you know, what it looks like right now?
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, and your scenarios.
I'm up for whatever you folks need to make an informed decision. I know the town meeting, you know, if it means me presenting the PowerPoint that I did several months back in front of the whole town, I have no issues doing that.
They might, yeah.
I think the numbers are a little more finite than when we were talking about it at that time.
Exactly.
And we have a little more, a much better handle based on what came back, what's available.
Right, and that might not be good, but at the same, I don't know. I mean, I haven't seen the numbers, but.
It is good.
Okay. But like I said, you know, we had a group of officers who, you know, really kind of sucked it up. And I know that folks don't want to hear that, but, you know, we cut their overtime significantly over this past year. And to be able to turn back money, to be honest with you, when I saw the number, I was pretty shocked myself.
Why? It was your plan. You came up with it.
I know, I understand, and I had confidence.
And it worked.
It did. You know, but like I said, at the same time, I don't want to.
No, but you'd like to take that money.
There's still more steps to go.
If you're able to save money, like you said, you're able to, and you can take that money and put it to good use and put more officers on, then that's your goal. And, you know, I appreciate that.
That is the goal.
Me too.
I think that's, you know, the way that we're looking.
The goal is to, and I know, you know, we've talked about it many times, the part-time and special officers. The goal is really to put the overtime money and the part-time money to better use. And not that it's, you know, not that part-time officers aren't an excellent advantage for us. They add extreme supplementation.
Every employment place has to have part-time people. You have to have that to fill in.
Absolutely. But just the way that I'm viewing this whole umbrella is that is not the best use of the town's money.
No.
Certainly not the overtime portion, because you're paying for hours that there's no work being done.
Could I ask you something? We really went through the appointment really quickly. And could you briefly explain why we filled that position so quickly and the ramifications it would have with the union if we didn't and the hours, so the people understand?
The position right now, since it has been open since the resignation, essentially, by the way that the contract reads, we are obviously required to keep someone in that spot. Whether it's full-time or part-time, that is money that we are paying out of different line items, overtime and part-time, that we really need to be conserving that money. And the full-time status, that line item is the money that is earmarked for that position. The contract, the way that it's set up, basically requires us to fill it. So we're paying time and a half to put somebody in that spot. And right now, I believe it's in the day shift. It's an open day shift, so we have Sergeant Cook is on is the supervisor on days right now, so he works with basically a different person every day, because we have to continue to fill that spot. Sometimes it's overtime, we're paying time and a half, sometimes it's part-time. So the reason we want to move on it so quickly is so that we can use the money that is actually appropriated for that position and put it to good use.
So would that be all right then if we have a focused discussion on this with some numbers in front of us next Wednesday at our select board meeting?
Yeah. Excellent.
Okay. All right. And by the way,
Cook,
you mentioned
I think
your
that's
right
good
hook.
Training for you anyway.
Right.
Yeah.
Right hook.
I'm left-handed.
As am I.
Yeah. Okay. Right.
Whichever one you want.
Yeah. Okay.
Fine.
Just check.
I won't take that against you.
All right. Thank you.
Thank
okay.
you.
Thanks.
We have to go finish up. Over here.
Okay.
Okay. So just looking at the agenda items, I think we have some folks here for a water abatement. Can we take that board?
Who's here?
I'm sorry, I can't say your last name.
Kozakowski.
I'm with 6 River Drive.
Okay. And I'm just trying to pull this up. Why do I have Mate?
pulled it up at home, but it's not going to come up on mine today.
We're doing the sewer abatement or the water abatement?
It's the sewer.
Oh, it's the sewer one, okay, I'm looking at the water.
That was the broken pipe?
Yep.
It's the same house.
Yep. Go ahead, Jennifer.
He's asking for a full abatement on the sewer because the house has been open for the last year and a half. Vacant for the last year and a half. So there has been no water use, using the average is what we used last time. And he's saying, he's requesting that because there was no one in the home that we look at those bills specifically where there is no use at all. We looked at the last few bills and the time that the house has been vacant and came up with a new average based on the amount where that house was vacant, and that would have been $46.26 as an abatement. If you wish to adjust it to the vacant number, or you could, at his request, do a full abatement of zero for the sewer because none of the water went into the sewer since it was a pipe bursting.
So we had a pipe that burst in the building?
Yeah, two places.
In the cellar?
Yes. Oh, it all drained in the cellar.
Okay, so the water never went through the sewer, but the water burst
upstairs. Went out in the field because it's drained in the floor. And it cut all the water.
So we as town hall staff, we have to go by a formula, but the select board are free to declare that the building was vacant and that there was no water use, therefore no sewer use.
There was water.
There was water
only
use,
flowed through.
But there was a vacancy, and the only water use was associated with a break that did not include a discharge to the sewer system.
So the sewer system never received
the
water.
Right.
I'm of a mind to grant the abatement. I'd like to make a motion that we grant the abatement back based on the fact that it was a water pipe burst in the building, not a leak or anything else other than that. Since the water didn't flow through the sewer and the expense was not incurred by the sewer department, I would like to request the abatement be granted.
Yeah. Do I have a second on that?
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
We have a second one here?
Is there another one here?
There is.
The water for the same house.
Okay. Jennifer?
This is 10 Rocky Hill Drive Road.
Oh, it's a different one, sorry.
I'm sorry.
Road.
It's 10 Rocky Hill Road.
Nowhere near Shimoda.
William Gnatic is requesting a water abatement. The DPW is recommending no abatement at this time. The water did pass through the meter. He did have plumbers in to check it. The DPW provided a dye kit. It didn't show a leak, so the water did pass through the meter. And so that's the recommendation of the DPW is no abatement because it did pass through the water on his side of the meter.
Was there possibly a leak after the meter that caused the rate to increase so much?
Well, he had a plumber come in and look. The plumber could not find anything. And DPW cannot know what the water use is on every property. They use the meter for that and the reading. And they did go back and do another additional reading, which shows a rate increase that is
It's lined up with what's being abated. The water is flowing through the meter and the meter is fine.
So
he's got a leak after the meter then now?
Yes, or there's use.
Or there's use.
Okay,
thoughts? Based on the recommendation of the DPW, I would advise against this abatement.
Second.
Okay, any further discussion?
How long has that place been closed?
Quite a while.
From time to time, there's people there, though.
Mm. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
You abstaining, Jen?
Abstain.
Thank you.
Okay, that's it for the abatements. So let's see, we have North Hadley Village Hall real estate proposal, Joel Greenbaum. David?
So late in the process for last select board meeting on August 17th, we received a proposal from Mr. Joel Greenbaum amending his offer for property North Hadley Village Hall. He had bid out $72,000 for the hall plus a portion of the land, but not the entirety of the land. He's now amended that proposal to increase in the amount of money to $100,000, but he wants all the property so there would be no carve out. We received this information just a few hours before your last meeting, so we touched upon it, but we said that we'd come and bring this back for full discussion after public disclosure at this particular meeting. So I know that the Zoning Board of Appeals has a meeting scheduled for September 19th to address the request from Mr. Greenbaum to convert the North Hadley Village Hall into residential units. I don't recommend that we sign this particular proposal to purchase real estate because it contains terms and conditions which are not part of the original RFP. And just to remind people, the original RFP included a provision to sell North Hadley Village Hall as is, and this particular proposal has a condition that this offer is good if he receives the Zoning Board of Appeals approval. Mm-hmm. That's a change in the scope of work, which we can't do under procurement law. But you can certainly negotiate a higher price for the property than you originally accepted. So you can choose to wait until the Zoning Board of Appeals has their hearing on the 19th. You can consider this right now. I don't recommend rejecting the offer. I think it's an offer made in good faith, and we should have a serious conversation about it.
It so differentiates from the original RFP that I would not want to vote on that.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
I'll put that in the form of a motion. I'll second.
How shall I word that?
Well, it depends on what you want to do. If you're going to continue to discuss this matter and see what the Zoning Board of Appeals has to say, then that's one form of a motion. Or you can accept the concept of enhanced amount of money for additional land, or you can take this under advisement and send it out to study.
Send it out to study with
who?
Well, you have the Municipal Building Committee, you mm-hmm. have the ad hoc committee,
mm-hmm.
You have building inspector. Any of those would have some comments on this.
According to the agreement, it says in there, if he isn't granted the zoning variance, he would walk away from the project.
That is correct.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it would behoove us to wait to the 19th till a decision is made, and it still shows that we're acting in good faith.
Is that a motion?
Yes, it is.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion on that motion?
Personally, I'd like to see it wait until after a town meeting results at this point.
Town meeting?
You mean the petitioned articles?
Yeah.
Right. Well, zoning, ZBA is going to be meeting prior to then anyway. So.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, do we still want to put it out for a comment from the Municipal Building Committee and the Ad Hoc Committee, or? I mean, it would still fall in line with the motion that Donald made, but do we want other people's input on this? I'm just asking.
I would think they would give their input prior to us having the meeting to make the decision.
Yeah.
Right,
so
but,
I think
but
it'd be,
we need to make sure they know about it.
We'd have to let them know and post the agenda, and they would learn.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, this is public record now anyway, so it can be passed around to the committees and boards. And
correct.
Right. David, would that be... we make sure it gets in the hands of the Municipal Building Committee.
Sure.
And
yep.
Okay. Any reason it would be problematic to stay the course with what we discussed last time and wait for ZBA?
No, I think that people have to be very clear that this is a select board process at this point, so the recommendations, any recommendations, any communication has to flow through the select board. There can't be any kind of trading or dealing on the side. That would be against the procurement laws, so.
Right, no, we're just listening.
Definitely has to come back to you.
Clearly.
Yeah.
Thank you, yeah. Okay, John, do you have something?
Yeah. I would hope this board just allows the process and go through the ZBA, and it releases the select board, it relieves liability, and it's gonna be dealt there, and that's it. Just takes a lot of questions right out of the ballpark.
Okay, so we have a motion made and seconded. Are we ready to vote? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. All right, and will you notify Mr. Greenbaum?
Yes, I will, and I think the chair of the municipal building committee is right there, so we'll get you the information.
David is not here, is he?
Yeah.
Well, I thought Willie was the chair.
Co-chair.
Co-chair, yeah.
Okay, co-chair. Thank you for helping me understand that.
Me too.
How's that jet lag working out, David?
Slow.
When's the gavel falling?
We have preparation for a public forum in the event that we needed to have our own conversation about it. Have we adequately covered our game plan at this point, or is there anything else we should discuss right now?
If we could just identify who would be at that meeting and interested in presenting, if we could do that now, I think we'd all understand and give everybody in the limited amount of time that we have available, and then we can figure out how many people are presenting and give an idea to each individual organization how much time they will have to present. So,
okay. My hope is that people are there to provide input, but that it's not a series of presentations. And I think the point of this is really to have the select board driving it, with, you know, the school department doing their own presentation. Meaning, I think if we already had the one meeting before, when last year, season, mm-hmm. whatever it was, when we went over to Hopkins, and you remember people came and they all said their piece and said what was important to them and all of that. Mm-hmm. I don't think we want a repeat of that, and my fear is that if we throw it out to say everybody can make, who wants to make a presentation, that we're gonna have a disconnected set of presentations.
Would the buildings committee input on their recommendation to the select board be helpful to people who attended the forum and to be on the television as to why they made the recommendations and the recommendations that were made?
Yes. So I think, so tonight what we talked about was asking for department heads in particular to be there and be available to the best of their ability, and definitely the municipal buildings committee be there, but I wouldn't necessarily see them doing a PowerPoint presentation. I think maybe we can just talk through, take elements of what they've already presented to us, put it in the form of a couple of PowerPoint slides, but then certainly defer to David, Willie, whoever, to talk to the extent that they want to.
Yeah, I mean, the question's gonna be directed at them anyways. So.
Right.
Now, all the talk that we just heard is all about the financial forum, okay?
Yes.
I personally feel it's bigger than Hadley, and I think we should invite Senator Rosenberg, Representative Seibeck, and maybe even Congressman McGovern to give us an outlay of what's happening in federal and state government, and then after them, they could go first and leave to go to other appointments and then go into Hadley's finances. But it would show the big picture of everything, how we have to deal with funding coming in from federal and state levels.
While I like the idea of them having an open forum for that, it turns into other issues that are political in nature rather than Hadley in nature. And I was with McGovern today when he was doing the farm tours, and while we were there talking about farm tours, it got into a whole host of other things that people attended the farm tours and went in other directions with immigration and other things that were going on. So I really want to focus on Hadley in these meetings and not go off into different tangents. We only have 2 hours to have these discussions. If somebody grabs Seibeck about an issue that they have and we get kind of bogged down in that, we're not going to have the time to focus on the issues that we need.
Couldn't we handle it with a moderator and eliminating time?
Well, it's hard, we have a lot to cover in 2 hours without bringing them into it. I kind of agree with, you know, Jerry, that we need to focus on what we're doing here.
And they really are an asset to us. They do what they can for us all the time. They're aware of our situations on just about every aspect.
Donald's point is good, though.
Yeah.
For the people who are hammering, I'm wondering why we get less money for the schools.
Yeah.
You know, there's Rosenberg and Seibeck there to say, you know, there's just no money from the state level, and this is what's going on, and that's what's going on. But those things blow into our conversations in and of themselves, and we're getting nothing accomplished as far as what we're trying to do.
Right, and I think we can speak to those. I mean, the school committee is going to be represented. We're represented. Again, some of the bigger issues like the Berkshire gas moratorium, the school choice, the charter reimbursement formula, if those things come up, anything that we're not aware of, we can take it under advisement and then turn it over to the legislators and promise people that we'll get back to them. I agree. I think ideally we keep it focused on Hadley. So are there other people you were thinking about, Jerry, to present? Or I mean, capital planning? What are you thinking?
No, I just was wondering who we wanted there and how we wanted those discussions to go. I didn't know other. It's just going to be a state of the union. This is where we are. This is what
but
we
I
have
think,
available.
You know,
this
I don't
is what
think
we've
people
done.
Have heard a whole lot from capital planning either over mm-hmm. the years, and it might give them an overview of how much is on our agenda, not just dealing with mm-hmm. our buildings, but what else we're dealing with on the other side of the coin with equipment and
mm-hmm.
Other issues of capital improvement. So
we could talk a little bit about it, but our meeting's on the 12th, and this is in advance of that.
Okay.
So
right.
I think Joyce is right, because say if Marlo gets up, he's probably going to talk about a five-year projection, like all department heads would. And I
mm-hmm.
think the capital planning would tie it all together, how they think that they can make it all work. So they probably wouldn't speak that long, but I think it would be very valuable to have them there.
Right, because
yeah,
like Article 5, Jerry, is on. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's just...
It hasn't been wed through that yet, though.
Yeah.
That's
right.
A $2 million
right.
project,
right.
and
but
it hasn't
again,
been wed through yet.
That's what's on the table, and
mm-hmm.
that's exactly mm-hmm. what is needed in this town, is $2 million worth of equipment.
Be happy to talk to that.
Okay.
So maybe when we have this on our agenda next week,
yep.
For that pre-organizational meeting, then we can be looking at specific areas and then decide who wants to or is willing to speak to what. I think it would also be good to have, you know, not just one person, you know.
You don't want to be monotone?
Or, yeah, me or Dave. I mean, it should, you know, try to get as many people to break it up as possible. So.
Yeah. But you want to check with Brian to see if he wants to moderate this? Would that be a, or do you want to just run this from the
we
table?
I think it's... I think it's going to be good for the select board to kind of show some leadership on this front.
I think you're right.
Yeah. So
that day yeah. earlier, we'll have a department good. Head meeting. I'll bring this issue up as well as the other things that we have to do. So
yeah.
people will have a sense that they need to be there and they have a role to, they have a role to play and information to contribute.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Anything else on that? Okay. If not, then let's see. We did the appeal.
8.1.
Okay. David, we have a letter of retirement. I think you wanted to speak to that.
Yeah. So we did receive from Michael Klimowski a letter stating that he was retiring from the town of Hadley. The last day of work will be October 29th. It's hard to imagine. Someone who has been anybody who could be more dedicated to the town of Hadley. He's worked here literally for decades. I think it's 32 years.
42.
42 years. Jet lag. 42 years under conditions that people can only imagine, and he had to endure such as snowstorms at any hours. The dike issues,
water main breaks,
sewer collapses,
more dike issues.
Absolutely.
he's
always been there for the town. He's always served the town as best as anybody could. And I've worked with him. I've had the pleasure of working with him for 11 years. I respect him professionally, I like him personally, and I'm happy for him for his retirement, but I also am sad that we're going to be not seeing him around like we always have in the past. And so I congratulate him on his years of service, his decades of service for the town of Hadley, and wish him well in his retirement.
So I'm just going to go right down the line, because I have a feeling everybody up here has something they want to say about Michael. Donald, do you want to start?
Yeah, I've known Michael for 40 years, 25 years ago, you know, as a selectman, and it was amazing what he could do. And I think the biggest thing that he ever got the town through was that October snowstorm, when all the trees snapped everywhere in town. We lost electricity for 3 days. He was up 3 days in a row dealing with all this, and he did a tremendous job to get us through it, you know. And like our chairman says, everybody's got accolades for him, and could go on and on, but I'm going to stop there and let Joyce take it.
I've known Mike from school committee to select board, and he has just been, has always stepped up to the plate whenever we've needed him. He's filled in for our directors and our head of the department, and he did run the department for many years until we kind of changed it over to DPW, and he did an outstanding job and never said no. Could ask him to do anything, and he was always there for everybody. So I can only wish him best of luck and hope that he enjoys his retirement and enjoys the farming like he usually likes to do, and have good health and, you know, stay healthy.
Jerry?
I spent a little time with Michael on Monday morning after he turned in his resignation, and he said, you know, guys, I'll always be there. He says, I don't know what I'm going to do tomorrow morning, because I've done nothing but eat, drink, sleep, and breathe Hadley for the last 42 years of my life. And I said, I know, Mike, and we, so many people owe you a debt of gratitude for that, and me certainly as much as anybody else. I'd like to read the last letter, of the last sentence of his resignation. I'd like to thank all the people of Hadley who I've worked with during my many years of service. Again, on the way out the door, he's thanking everybody for helping him as opposed to him helping us. Thanks, Mike, for your many years. And he said to make sure, and he told it to Marlo exactly, I'm not going anywhere. I'm here to help. I'm not disappearing. When you guys need something, I'll be there for you like I have for the last 42 years. And I appreciate that, Michael. And I'm going to miss you.
John?
Pretty much everything's been said. He's been a great boss, great guy to work with. And somehow the whole team down there just got the job done for the last 42 years.
So I guess the only thing that I would add to that is, again, a lot of it's already been said, but when I think about Michael, I think of a true gentleman, and he's a good soul. And anybody that that knows him knows exactly what I mean by that. So certainly wish Michael well into the future, and I have no doubt that we're going to see him around, and I would encourage folks to reach out to him and thank him themselves. I don't think he really understands how much people appreciate what he's done for 42 years here. So we wish you well, Michael, if you're watching at home. John?
Yeah, I'd like to make a comment on Mike. I've known Mike probably maybe longer than most of you folks, and worked with him, did work for the town, and I really believe this town owes him a send-off retirement party. He's been such a great guy. He devoted maybe his most adult life to the town. And I certainly would do anything and everything I could to be a part of that for his retirement party. And I think it's really this town holds him that much. So
to the extent he's willing to accept that offer, I'm sure you'd have a lot of people helping you.
So. You just ruined the surprise party.
But it should start right there.
Exactly.
Really.
All right. So,
moving. We don't announce those things, John.
Are you going to accept the letter?
Pardon?
Right. Are you going to accept the
letter? Oh, my goodness gracious. So we need to take a vote. Yes. You making a motion, Jerry?
With heartfelt appreciation, I'd like to accept a letter of resignation from Michael Klimoski to the town of Hadley.
Just friendly amendment. It's a letter of retirement.
excuse me, letter of retirement.
I'll second that motion.
All in favor of accepting the letter of retirement?
Aye.
Abstain.
John, you're so good, right? You're just abstaining. Okay.
If you could vote, how would you vote?
Obviously, I'd love to accept it.
Okay, GE contract water membrane replacement.
Have we had our attorney review this? God, is this one-sided.
Did you want to speak to us, or you just want to go, or Marlo, or?
Marlo is here. We have a, just briefly, and Marlo is going to give you more of the details. We know that our membranes for the ultrafiltration plant down at the at Callahan Water Well have a 10-year life use life, and they're reaching the end of that use life. We have been setting aside money for 10 years to replace that. We have additional money to raise. There is a 120-day manufacturing process. So Marlo is coming to you today in advance of the town meeting vote that would appropriate the money to ask that if you would accelerate the replacement of the water filtration membranes by approving, subject upon the availability of funds, the contract to begin the manufacturing process so that these membranes can be replaced before springtime. Otherwise, we'll have to wait.
Are you doing all of them?
Yes, this is the complete membrane replacement.
Complete membrane of
yes.
The water treatment plant.
The yes. Price that we have on here, that's a manufactured, delivered, and installed price?
We're going to install them. There's a $3,000 extra in there for GE to come in because we've never done them. And these things are very delicate. You don't want to drop them. You don't want to tip them on their side. They have a very delicate shelf life. That's why there's a 120-day wait on them. They don't sit on a shelf like one of our water distributor plants or something like that.
So we have 168 at $686.50 for a total price plus the delivery, freight and delivery of $30,000. So we're at $145 here. Now we also have on the capital plan monies that's identified there.
Yes, we've been.
We have some money that's been put aside and saved. How much have we saved?
We've saved $100,000, and we were looking for the other $48,000 in fall town meeting. Jerry, what this does is it allows us to get, if we were to order them the next few weeks, it gets them in somewhere in the first couple of weeks of January. When we're not pumping real heavily, as we all know, we've been pumping water like crazy this summer. And it gives us an opportunity to get these swapped out, say, midwinter, as opposed to receiving them in March, April, when we really get going on the pumping. It's hard to shut the plant down and to do maintenance, let alone swap these membranes out while it's pumping on.
So why can't we take this from water reserves?
Hang on one second, if I can finish my thought here, and I am with you 100%. But on our capital plan, we have $153,000. That shows up on our capital plan too. Okay, but we don't need $153,000 on our capital plan. We need to come up with an additional $48,000 for this to occur, right?
Right.
Because we have $100,000 already set aside.
Right, but you need to appropriate that $100,000 as well as the additional money in order to make the contract. So you need a town meeting vote. Joyce, that answer your question about taking it out of reserves. You need a town meeting vote to appropriate the money. We're just asking that, subject to the town meeting vote, if we can get a 40-day drop on the 120-day manufacturing process, that puts us in a position to install these at a sweet time of water usage so that there's minimal disruption or risk.
But when the capital planning committee meets, they look at a number that says $153,000
right
there. And it's being appropriated by cash, water capital funds, water reserves, et cetera, but truly what we actually need to get that we don't currently have is, I don't know if it's 48 or 53. It says 153 here.
It says 45 on that.
I know, but on this one it says 153. I don't know if that also includes other things other than just the membranes, the freight, and the expertise to make sure that we do it properly.
I'm not positive, I don't have the contract with me, but I think 145 covers everything to get it here.
Yes.
If I recall. The other 3,000 is for somebody from GE to assist us in changing these out for the very first time.
So we'll probably be adjusting this number to 148
right.
from 153.
There's a contingency in there, so that's the reason for the additional money there, but we can shave this a little bit in order to save some money.
Those are the kind of things that I'm talking about with understanding on a in front of
exactly.
people,
right.
the capital planning. Okay, we don't need 153, we've put 100 aside already.
Mm-hmm.
We need a substantial number, more than 100 we've put aside to get it freighted. I'm afraid of $30,000, I don't think we appropriated money for that. We appropriated money for the actual filter replacements of the 168 at $658 a piece, but we need the freight number and the consultation to make sure that we do it right.
Are the engineers involved with the safety and the cleaning of those once they're removed? Is that part of that 153?
Yes,
originally?
I believe so, yes. Well.
So I'm sorry, Joyce, I finished my original point if you wanted
I'm
to
sorry.
Go.
Sorry, no, me
you did not at all. I wanted to finish my point, though.
That's fine.
He likes that.
I like that point.
The beginning, middle,
that
and end.
153 yeah. was for the safety catwalks above and for the cleaning of the tanks once the screens were removed, I believe. That's what came up with that extra amount.
And then I
just to your thought, so the total amount for the whole project is what?
Probably between 148 and 153.
Okay, so we already have 100,000 plus side.
Yeah.
Okay, so I was confused. I was looking at, you wanted to do another 100,000.
That's what I was
yeah.
wondering.
Yeah.
Right. Okay,
no.
So no, it's just 148.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
yes.
also in this contract, it says, you know, in kind of a big open field that, you know, you probably should have everything checked and tested while everything's apart. And we have no idea what that cost would that be to do anything else. And I'm just kind of smelling that, you know,
I'm smelling that
we are really open to somebody saying, well, you know, geez, you know, we need another $180,000 because we got a couple broken cylinders and we're just ordering these and then they're going to show up and then we're going to start changing things out. And it doesn't make any sense to have anybody to pay to have someone come out in advance and project whether or not there's going to be any further expenses before town meeting and before we go ordering $153,000 worth of stuff to, I've never done it. I mean, I don't know.
And I have an answer to that. We've already done that.
Okay.
A couple weeks back, we brought GE in. We're having some problems when we were doing some cleans on these membranes. So we had somebody come in from GE and we went through some things. We pulled out one of the cassettes. Yes, we found some broken parts, some standpipes, needed a bunch of O-rings. We were getting a lot of air bubbles. This is what led, a lot of that led me to being here tonight asking to get a jump start on these membranes.
Well, the O-rings are included.
Yes, but I'm saying when we pulled this thing apart, it was already leaking. The plant got pushed hard this summer. I mean, that's not because the membranes, are gone. But they're like it's hard to explain. The initial membranes are not the amount of the membranes we're getting either. It's kind of like when you buy a printer, you get a small cartridge, but just a cartridge you can buy twice the amount.
Right.
So that's what we're getting out of this. We're getting more cassettes. We're getting more surface area.
I think the perfect example that maybe they can comprehend to is your swimming pool filter.
Mm-hmm.
If you were to take your swimming pool filter out, and if you had one on the shelf that turned to dust already because you bought it and it sat around for 5 years,
mm-hmm.
you don't want to do that, but the one you take out and put on the shelf and it disappears, this is what he's trying to talk to you about. If when these things are manufactured, they need to be put in service right away. They need to be in service and working to be warranted for 10 years. If they, we
Two
have
years.
Kind of, how long?
2 years.
Well, their life expectancy is 10.
Yeah.
But if they're sat around for any amount of time, then, you know, you may be looking at 8 years before you need to replace the next set, you know?
So you had this done, GE was out here
yeah,
and,
well,
and
we,
made
we
some...
We had somebody come out and help the crew understand how these trains come out, how they're replaced, kind of like a little bit of a dry run. And while they did that, there's some tubing, some connector tubing, some return manifold tubings that we've already ordered, that we are ordering, where we're already taking care of those parts and pieces within our budget. There's nothing else really in there, in those tanks, that they're gonna say, I know, I want another $100,000. It's parts and pieces. It's expensive because they're one of a kind, so to speak. But there's nothing in there that's gonna say $100,000. We may, you know, have to quickly order. We're gonna have some things on hand already anyways, ahead of time, in case we run into any of the O-ring issues or the standpipe manifold type tubing problems.
I don't think there was any spare parts along with that plant anyway when it was built. Yeah.
Well, when they pulled the membranes out to do this dry run, they found some broken return lines. It's not hurting anything, but it's affecting the performance of the system.
All right, I see we're going to Hungary and buying a product called Z-Weed. And it's supposed to be better than the ones that are actually there now that we're currently using, because 10 years later things get better. Do you know anything about these products, or if there's anything else that's available that's better, or you've talked to GE and this is what they recommend for our particular plant?
This whole thing was set up, I mean, we haven't signed the contract. I have not done any further investigating. It was all set up when we started saving the money 5 years ago. I suspect that, well, actually the difference is, this was $148,000, whichever the figure is, was the first time replacement bargain, let me say bargain. The next set's gonna be $260,000, and I've already reflected that in my capital starting next year, to split that up over the next 10 years. So,
and since
the answer to your question is no, I don't think anybody went out and looked, because we got the discount on the first time round from GE, so.
Okay.
So you have a sense of urgency.
Their engineers could have updated some of this stuff too over the last.
Yeah, it's a sense of urgency. We had to clean the plant a lot more frequently than normal. We were pumping some serious gallons of water.
Mm-hmm. And that's been addressed with the fact that we are buying an increased membrane permeability and a more resistant to fouling with an increased range of tolerance. I see that there's what they're recommending to us is a better product than what was originally put in. It's what they're telling us, and that's great. I mean, that's what I want to hear.
And the caveat is, when we pull these things out, if there's any of them in the center that got any useful life left to them, there's open slots even remaining after these new ones go in that we're going to tuck them in there and continue to use them and get every last ounce of life out of them. So
I'll make a motion to direct Marla to put an order in for these membranes.
This is a contract signed,
contract,
isn't it?
Yes.
I'll make a motion to sign the contract.
I'll second it. Where are we getting the money? We got $100,000, and we got to wait till town meeting to approve the money.
Mm-hmm.
We got $100,000.
And it can come from water reserve, is what I'm anticipating.
Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Is that part of your motion?
It's part of my motion that the remaining balance be taken from water reserve.
Until fall town meeting, where it'll be transferred back.
Correct.
We don't have an article in fall town meeting, do we?
Yes. We actually do.
That's what
the 153 is.
Yeah, that's what, that's what Jerry is looking at.
Okay.
I'll second one piece motion. Of information, I'm not sure we signed the contract. The point is I'm not sure we're not going to get billed if these things are delivered safely.
I was asking at the payment terms, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they're not going to arrive next week. That's why there's 120 days out.
But you never want to sign a contract if you don't know what our standpoint, when you know what the funding is.
And, I'm here because I wanted to get the process going, and obviously the funds weren't in with the rest of them yet, so.
Okay. Motion made and seconded. Mm-hmm. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Upstain.
And there's a substantial savings because Marlo's brought GE in to explain how these things are going to get done, and it's going to be utilizing town help in order to get this done. The original price was in excess of $300,000.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay. All set? Mm-hmm. Are we good? Thank you, Marlo.
Thank you.
Can I ask a question before he leaves?
Sure.
Can you give us an update on the water ban situation, how we're at and what it looks like?
When we, right now, we're actually being controlled by DEP, how our water restriction sets is sitting, excuse me. So right now, we were under mandatory restriction, under the parameters we're under. We cannot downgrade that until the state DEP upgrades us from drought watch back to an advisory. So in other words, under our SOP with DEP, we really can't move until they upgrade the drought situation under our accepted SOP through them. So until we get some rain, the river elevates a little bit and they pull us off that watch, we're kind of stuck, mandated under DEP to stay right where.
So are all the other communities also?
Correct.
Everyone's
under
that.
This whole area is under that same.
So in that case, I did have a phone call from someone that wants to know, and of course, most of our concentration has been out here on Route 9 for the last few weeks. Your automatic water sprinkler systems for businesses, banks, and things like that, how are we controlling those and having them not do that?
We had a pretty good response to that. There wasn't a whole lot of them on after we got it out to the press on the website. The few that we came across, our water department simply pulled in, knocked on the door, gave them a copy of it and explained it to them, and they gladly shut it off. And every now and then one will pop back on there on timers. But I will say that we haven't, the community's been very good about helping us out with the issue with the ban and the restriction. We really haven't had a lot of policing to do. You know, we'll knock on a door, and people have been very good about it. We've had a few phone calls with some really tricky situations, but we tried to help the taxpayer as much as we can without.
Are tank levels rising at an adequate amount at night?
Tank levels and water amounts have not been an issue at all. The issue is the withdrawal amounts we're allowed to withdraw from our system to provide. We were not double, but pretty close to double for quite a while there over our withdrawal permit. So our water situation is not a problem. It's just we're controlled under DEP what we can send out to everybody.
John?
Yeah, I'd like to ask Marlo a question. I have had several residents ask me, like, why are we banned from water and a state can go hook the hydrant and use all the water they want?
The
or
state?
The contractor that's doing Route 9 here. So you ban the residents in town that pay their water bills and everything else, but the contractor can hook up.
Well, the contractor knew we were under a ban. I hadn't realized it was still taking water off the standpipe.
Well, why can't they pump it from a river or somewhere else?
Correct. Or bring it in.
If you ban the community, you should ban them.
Okay. I'll touch base with the contractor.
It's fair,
that's to me. I suspect they're also trying to keep dust control down the best they can, which could be a serious problem.
There's calcium put down today. We'll get the students coming back again, not to divert this conversation too much, but the center town's in pretty rough shape, obviously. The students are coming back starting Friday, I assume. Is it going to be in that state? Are they working Friday? What's going on?
They're working 410s this week. I just found that out today. I had a schedule last week that I passed on to Mr. Nixon. So I found out they're working 410s. There's nothing going on out here Friday.
Friday to Monday. So Friday to Tuesday
Friday
morning,
Tuesday
they will not be working. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Yep.
All right. Okay, so you're all set then?
I'm all set. You're all set.
Excellent. Okay. Then the last item we have is closing the special town meeting warrant and article review. So we went through the warrant articles during the tri-board meeting. Is there anybody here that had an interest in any warrant article or that wants to talk?
No? I thought we were going to discuss the, or were we going to bring that up at another time, the raise and appropriate for the bonuses. Are we going to wait and talk about that?
I think David was going to give us information at another time. Or
yeah,
no?
So all I have is a fragmentary request.
Okay,
and I
that's
want to
fine.
Make sure that I understand it. Gives the Department's a fair hearing. There
that's
are a number of questions I have about this one. So let's find out what the deal is.
How did it get on here?
It was a requested article.
Okay, so any further discussion on the special town meeting warrant articles, or are we prepared to close the warrant?
Make a motion to close it.
Second for discussion.
Mm-hmm. Discussion?
I think I erroneously gave David the wrong list from the capital planning, I mean, from the...
Can he make changes?
Municipal building committee?
Yeah, so that, I think that there's three articles on there that I gave you by mistake that they did not wish to put on.
But the ones that are on?
Yes, I will be coming back after next Tuesday's meeting with them and clarifying that. But that was my fault, not theirs.
Okay.
We can always remove them.
We can take them off.
Yeah.
It's just if they weren't there and we needed to, yeah, we have to.
Okay.
Oh, but Jeff?
I asked that question, I got a question on the bonuses for certifications.
Yeah, I don't think we have any information, though, that's the problem.
Well, I thought that just anybody can come in and throw an article in, and the selectmen obviously didn't know nothing about it. I would have thought this would have been submitted before to the selectmen for discussion and what their thoughts were.
Yeah, my recollection is that this was something that did come up as a discussion point last year during the budget process, that there was some conversation about this.
Yeah, I think it was through those SWAT.
Right, yeah.
Doesn't the town pay these folks to get certificates?
We're not discussing it tonight because we don't have any information.
I asked the question.
Just to talk a little bit about the process, so on June 1st, I asked the selectmen to open the warrant. At that time, I presented a preliminary draft warrant, which I believe had something on the order of a dozen articles, which we knew that we would be addressing. There was a number of housekeeping issues, a number of regulatory issues, a number of planned budgetary issues that would be coming up. So those articles were presented to all the parties, finance committees, select board, capital planning, et cetera. In the meantime, while the warrant is open, anybody can submit an article. It's like casting a net into the sea, drag it in, whatever fish are there, that's what I'm obliged to present to the select board. So it's up to the select board at this point to dispose of these articles as appropriate.
Okay, so we have a motion made and seconded to close the warrant. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, so warrant is closed. And then announcements? Any announcements this evening?
Three county fairs this weekend. As a director, I'm obligated to tell everybody, come visit the fair.
And the ticket charge at the door, Jerry?
Regular price. Friday.
Good answer.
Friday, veterans are in for free.
What's that regular price? You don't want to say it.
I think it's 12 and 10. Actually, I'm not working the gate this year. That's why I believe it's 12 and 10. This year, I'm checking IDs.
Okay.
I've been promoted.
Any other announcements? No? Okay, yes?
Excuse me.
Go.
I just found out that Hadley has been designated as the spot where the scenic byway is going to have their... I'm not sure exactly what they're going to call it. There's a name for it, but it's going to be the information booth for the National Scenic Byway,
oh, really?
Which is Route 47,
sure.
Or River Drive,
yeah.
From north to south in Hadley.
Do you know where the location of the booth is?
Tentatively, it's going to be at the Port of Phelps Huntington House.
Really?
Just to start.
Yeah.
And they're having a grand opening, ribbon cutting, whatever, this coming next Wednesday.
Okay. 7th?
7th.
All right, great.
1 to 4 at the Port of Phelps Huntington House.
Oh, that's nice. Yeah, good. Good. Anything else? Marlo?
Real quick note, just so everyone knows, the water work portion of the Route 9 project is complete. They completed the last few compliant things today. I'm just waiting on the final estimates to come in. I will say that I think we did quite nicely. When I have the finals, I'll certainly pass it on to Mr. Nixon, and we'll see where we end up with this whole thing. But it's complete, our end of it, so we're good.
Right.
Now
excellent.
On to 2020.
Well done.
Yes. Yeah, that's right, on to 2020.
I assume the parking issue with Mr. Zavala, you've checked that since you've rectified the situation?
Almost every morning on the way.
Excellent.
Yes.
Everybody's happy.
There's a quick log jam for them to get out of there with their equipment, but nothing's parked in there during the day.
Thank you very much.
So.
Okay, so that concludes our regular business, and we do have an executive session scheduled for this evening. Joyce, do you want to make a motion?
Certainly, I'll make a motion to go into executive session as per the provisions of MGL Chapter 30A, Section 21A1, to discuss the reputation, character, physical condition, or mental health rather than professional competence of an individual, or to discuss the discipline or dismissal of or complaints or charges brought against a public officer, employee, staff member, or individual. And the select board will not reconvene in open session.
Okay. As a chair? Yeah. Are we doing the...
Is there a second?
Second.
Oh, sorry.
No, as a chair.
Okay. As the chair, I believe that discussing this matter in open session would have a detrimental impact to the town of Hadley.
Roll call vote. Buskevitz?
Yes.
Devine?
Yes.
Keegan?
Yes.
Trunglo?
Yes.
Kuczynski?
No.
No.
All right, thank you.